So you must negotiate from a position of strength, otherwise just talking has no meaning. And any loose statement, any action which can be taken as a sign of weakness, we must avoid. That includes political statements by opposition leaders. The topic for today is understanding communist China. And this has become a necessity for the last 1,000 years. We have not really looked at China, though it has been our neighbor. Thanks to the Himalayas, we have been completely separated from it. However, after 47 and our independence, we have had to have direct communications with China on various accounts, and their behavior or in the national, so far as we are concerned, so and internationally has raised certain concerns, which has compelled us to have a re-look at what is happening around. Now, this is China is part of Asia, and this is a map of Asia. The north is China, you have the Mongolia, northwest is the Kazakhstan, then north Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Iran, Kabul, Pakistan, and to the south is India and Burma now it is Myanmar. Then the smaller nations of Thailand, Malaysia on the southeast, and the China Sea on the east of China. So China, as you see from the map, is a fairly large country. Fairly large country. And this is the modern map of China with its various, what equivalent of our states. You know, it includes the Tibet and Xinjiang. Okay. Now I am showing you some photographs which some of you, at least I am seeing some senior citizens here who remember good old days or happy days of Hindi Chini Bye Bye. You know, that is Mao Zedong on the left side, and you can see Nehru with Ramakrishnan and Chou En Lai, who was the Prime Minister, and Dr. Rajendra Prasad, who was our first President of India. Okay. And here is one of those later ones, another happy looking, smiling guys, wonderful things. Unfortunately, the situation on the ground does not really reflect these photographs today. Xi Jinping, this gentleman who is with Prime Minister Modi, he is the President of China, and when he took over as the General Secretary of the Communist Party, he left this message. He was very keen that China, people should understand China, the world should understand China, and the Chinese also should understand the world. Apparently, he did have a lot of things in mind when he said this. He, as the General Secretary of the Communist Chinese Party, is the most powerful person in China. The world did not take him as seriously, or his statement as seriously as they should have. There has been a complete change in the way China is looking at the world today. Since he has taken over, that the change in the way China has been approaching the world, the problem is not only for us. There have been flagrantly aggressive moves by China in the last 10 odd years. The ones about the Indo-Tibetan border, we already know. And the strategic encirclement, which he has planned through his OBOR. This is literally squeezing us in India with his roads from the top and our sea lanes from the south. These have generated concerns for us for various reasons. China has been saying it is all a matter of cooperation and meant for projects, and everybody is going to be goody-goody, happy-happy. But in actual fact, the way it has been progressing has not been really conducive to a sense of satisfaction or peace to those people who are the recipients of this OBOR. Then we have the support which Pakistan has been getting. Pakistan has been receiving some special favors from China. We have no objections to this. But the CPEC, that the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, which is supposed to bring so many good, beautiful things to Pakistan, is also a point of strategic concern. China has gone out of the way to block actions against naming terrorists in the UN. China has been blocking India in various international forums, including the nuclear suppliers group. So far as the world is concerned, the South China Sea, it is making illegal claims thanks to the 9-dash line, is not willing to accept the UNCLOS orders of the International Court. The East China Sea, it is bringing pressure on Taiwan and Japan, claiming sea lanes as their own. In trade, absolute blackmail techniques. They use any and every possible method to remind people that they can create problems for them. And then OBOR, countries are getting bankrupted. In the name of OBOR projects, China has been advancing loans. And these loans are at market rate. And countries have been saddled with up to 15% in foreign debt, international foreign debt. From 1% they have raised to 15%, which is very high. And we have seen what has happened to Hambantota in Sri Lanka, where they had to give this Hambantota on a lease of 99 years to China because they can't really repay that loan. So we need to tackle China. We have to know how to deal with this new China, which has modulated its approach to this world, and we must know how to deal with them. For that, maybe some of the lessons we have learned or which we had been following, the paths we have been following, certain judgments which we had made earlier might have to be revised. And we in India, frankly, have very little knowledge of what China is or its past, its geography, history. So we'll just touch upon some of those issues on which we as public must have at the back of our mind whenever we are talking of China, come to the real crux of the issue. Now, China's GDP, as you can see this graph, from 2010 to 20, it has gone from $9,000 per PPP to $16,000. It has come down a little bit last year because of this COVID, but then $16,000 per PPP in a year. And India is still at $6,000. This is how the dispersion has taken place. China has overtaken India in so far as its manufacturing concerns are there, the GDP growth is concerned. This tells you the vast change in our GDP growth and their GDP growth. The blue one is of China. Okay. Global exports, India exports up to 1.7%, China is 12.8%. And China is a major trading partner for nearly 50 countries in this world. We have a widening trade deficit with India, we all know that. And we keep saying ki isko kam karna hai, we have to reduce, we should buy less Chinese goods and all that. But last year, we have marginally reduced it by about $10-15 billion. But then again, it is going up this year. Forex reserve of China, mind-boggling, $3,290 billion. And ours is $580 billion. Yahan bhi there is a difference. The difference is Chinese have bought a lot of bonds, US bonds, and that is supposed to be backed up by bullion, US bullion. Our Indian 580 billion out of that, at least 300 billion are of this flighty types. You know, they come and they can vanish overnight, because they come for shares and bonds and things like that, and they can be pulled out overnight. So, though we have 580 billion, quite high compared to some countries, but then they are not in assets. They are not in assets. One weak point which China has today is that they have to import nearly 100 million tons of food every year. China is a larger country than India, but their arable land or the cultivable land is about half of ours. And they have been importing about 100 million tons of grain over the last 5-6 years. The industrialization has definitely picked up, but their agricultural produce has not kept pace with it. Now China is going ahead and investing in farmlands in Africa. In this OBOR, one of the points I read was that in Pakistan, they are planning to buy farmlands. But they will grow grains there and bring them over to China. Okay. Education level. They have got twice the number of PhDs studying at any point of time than what we have. And even at the vocational level, India has about 40 lakh students in the ITIs. They have double of what we are. And this gives them a great pool of skilled manpower, which comes in very handy for industrial growth. See, industrial growth, it's not engineers and PhDs who run the industries. It has to have skilled manpower available at any time. So far as infrastructure is concerned, you know, we have been spending about earmarking 3.5% of our GDP over the last 50 years, and China has been spending last 40, 50 years about 9% of the GDP. So you can see the difference. The skilled manpower availability, the amount spent on infrastructure. We did call for in our economic survey that we should raise this the investment in infrastructure to 7-8%. But thanks to the COVID, we have not been able to do it. It has come down to less than 5%. Their work on it, after the USA has been the top so far as infrastructure construction abilities are concerned. Massive projects. Anybody who has gone to USA has seen them. Chinese are catching up with them. Their infrastructure abilities are fantastic. They are able to build artificial islands in South China Sea. They built 5 or 6 of them already on those coral reefs. And one of them has, in the Spratly Islands, has got an airfield. Planes can land and take off. We have to understand what China is capable of today and where it stands today in the international arena. The military spending, in the last 5 years, China has been spending 261 billion, India is 71 billion. Okay, that's what it is. Some little comparison, just a passing. China, they say, has got 3,210 aircraft and India has got 2,100. These are numbers. I'm not talking about the quality of the aircraft or where they're getting the engines from. Okay. Just for comparison, China has got 507 serviceable ports and we got 346. Well, we are a smaller country. While passing, just remember this, two small things. Let's keep it in the back of the mind because we'll come to this again. China's twin centennial goals. Now, Communist China will be celebrating the centenary of the birth of the Communist Party in 2021. This is a major event so far as they are concerned. All right. And in 2049, they'll be celebrating the centenary of the People's Republic of China. Mind you, the Communist Party is formed in 2021, and it took the Communist Party about 28 more years of very hard fighting with the Kuomintang, with the Japanese, the Koreans. to really take over the country and form this Republic of China, People's Republic of China. So these two are coming up, and these two are actually, they have got certain goals for them. The Communist Party has set certain goals for itself, and Xi Jinping, as the boss of China today, has to deliver something special. And this obviously must be pressuring him quite a lot. Being the top man, being the strongest man is one thing, but then having to deliver, he's under immense pressure, which normally people don't realize and recognize. If you really want to understand China, let us look at it from Chinese point of view. We have always been looking at things from the European point of view, sometimes from the Indian point of view recently, but then we need to really understand China, we have to look at it from the Chinese point of view. What they think their assets are, and what they think their liabilities are, how they will be acting. If I'm a Chinese, what will I do? I got so much of foreign funds, I got so much of military power, what will I do? What should I do? I want to show that I am number one in this world, what will I do? Now, in the coming few slides, of course, I'll be talking more as an Indian than as a Chinese, but then we had to put ourselves in their shoes to really understand them. Otherwise, we'll be passing judgments based on our culture, our history, and our experience, which will not necessarily give us the right results. Okay. Now, remember, China is a large country, of course, and it is an ancient civilizational state. It's not just a normal state. You say USA, okay, it's a nation, trying to be a nation state, but it doesn't have the history like China has got. You know, China's empires have been there for the last 4,000 years, in 2000 BC, and they take pride in their empires and emperors. And this weighs quite heavily on them, that they are an old civilization, and people around are not as old as they are, though they do accept that India also has a civilization, quite old, but they don't realize that our civilization is twice as old as theirs. So they are very proud of their civilization. And the history of their empires, some of the major dynasties, of course, there have been hundreds of the kings and emperors and warlords. But then normally people say 5 major dynasties, and somebody says 13 major dynasties. I'll give a list of some of these dynasties. Of these, Song and Tang dynasties are supposed to have been the strongest and the best. Tang roads are still there, very popular in Chinese towns everywhere, I'm told. Qing dynasty, which is the last one, 1644 to 1912. The last 100 years of Qing dynasty in the 19th century, they were quite weak. And this weakness of the Qing dynasty was taken advantage of by the Europeans, who literally took over Shanghai and Canton and ensured certain treaties, which the Chinese resented at that point of time, and they still consider as very unjust treaties which were forced on them by the Western powers. And they think of this 150 years of these treaties till, and the Japanese invasion from 31 onwards as a dark patch on their history. They are literally ashamed of it. And they say, we have to break it and we have to show that we are back again as number one in this world. Okay. Now, how has been their relationship with their neighbors? Very strange. No, they have been having empires and emperors. There's the notes. They have been having their empires and emperors, right? Now, they don't look at people the way we do. What do we say? Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, everybody is equal and nice and beautiful and all that sort of thing. They don't look at the countries around them in the same fashion. They look at them in the sense of hierarchy. You know, China is the master and other countries around them are vassals. And it is a fact that starting from Japan to Korea to Malaysia to Vietnam, people have been paying respect to the Chinese emperor for hundreds of years. And they feel that today that once again they are powerful, all the countries in South Asia, Southeast Asia should accept their hegemony, accept the fact that they are number one. They would like India also to do the same. And if you are not doing it, they are not happy with you. And so far as race and ethnicity are concerned, Han dynasty was there 200 BC or so. And they consider all Chinese to be of the Yellow race, born in the on the banks of the Yellow River, Wang Ho, and 90 out of the 140 crores of their population, 90% they are considering them to be Han Chinese, and only 10% are others, who are the Tibetans and the Uyghurs, and a few odd from Mongolia and Manchuria. Father of Chinese Republic is Sun Yat-sen. Sun Yat-sen is comes. He was the one who declared the last Qing Chinese emperor. He was only 8 years old. He was deposed and he said China will be a republic from now on. You know what he says about race? Today, nobody talks about it openly, but this is what I read. Sun Yat-sen said, there are five types of people in this world, five grades, five types. On the top are the white men and the yellow men. Whites and yellow. Yellows are the only one who can call themselves equal to white, because they have initiative, they have drive, and they are powerful and intelligent and all that. At the bottom of the list, the black people. A little above the black people are the people from Southeast Asia. And little above them are people like us Indians. Okay. So this is how the father of the Republic of China categorized the human population. So you can imagine their today, of course, nobody dares to say it outside. And this is in contrast with what communism teaches. Communism says everybody is equal. Mao said everybody is equal. Mao did not agree with it. But then, these are somehow ingrained into them. We cannot avoid that. Race and ethnicity is a major issue with them. And even the diaspora, you know, how much attachment they got for their own country. And their diaspora is all over the world compared to us. How they are linked to their motherland, even after hundreds of years. And so let us keep this in mind, how their minds work, what they look at the people outside, do they treat people outside as equals, whatever they say, but in actual fact. And the polity, you see, people may say this is a republic, no more emperors. But the fact is, the mainland China is being run by a single party, that is the Chinese Communist Party. And the General Secretary of the party, he is the boss of China. He has got about 8 or 10 people who are in the Politburo, and what they say goes. There's no sharing of any responsibility with anybody. You know, other countries have, they share some responsibility or some power is there for the, used to be there for the church and things like that, however much they try to divide it. But in China, it is just one single party. They run everything. Party owns the army, party owns the country, party owns the industries, party owns the businesses. Even the ships and trawlers which are going out for fishing are the party. If a school headmaster is to be picked up, he has to be a member of the Communist Chinese Party. Otherwise, he cannot be a principal. You cannot be a governor unless you are there. If you have an RWA equivalent, the member of the RWA will be from the Chinese Communist Party. There are no elections. Well, they do have elections. Last time, I think the vice premier and premier, they were elected. Out of 2,000 odd people in their Grand Central Committee, everybody voted for him. The choice is very limited. Either vote for the for this candidate or you don't vote for him. And if you don't vote for him, you know what will happen. So that's how their country runs. It is run on a single party basis. There is no opposition. Officially, there's no opposition. So they are able to manage many things which we in a democracy are not able to manage the way they manage. Okay. And another issue or point which you must understand is the speed of transformation. I showed you that little thing about the GDP. How in the last 10 years, how the GDP has literally taken off. In the last 30 years, see, when in 1947, we got our independence. 49, they became the China became a People's Republic. The economic conditions of the both the countries were more or less the same. It continued like that for a good 20-25 years. From 1993, there has been a major change. The last three decades have been fantastic so far as China is concerned. We have been also growing, but at a much slower pace of 4%, 5%. They have been growing at 8%, 9%. It doesn't make a difference. And they could do it because of the polity. You know, one single party, an abundance of skilled manpower, and they were able to concentrate on things. The speed of transformation has definitely made certain changes in their society, has affected their society. It would be incorrect if we say that prosperity has come to everybody equally in China. It has not. So that is one of the reasons why Xi Jinping is going now for the OBOR. Okay, that's a different issue. We can talk about it some other time. An interesting part is the rebirth or reacquiring of affection to Confucius. Confucius was an ancient philosopher of China, and he had talked about filial piety and the loyalty of family members to the senior person, loyalty of the people to the village elders, loyalty of the elders to the warlords, loyalty of these small kingdoms to the emperor. You know, it is all a matter of hierarchy. He said there is hierarchy, and everybody is not to be considered as equal. People have their own status in life. But he also ensured emphasis on meritocracy, which still continues till today. China is one of those few countries which had central examinations. Anybody who wanted to get into the emperor's service had to clear examination, which was centrally held. They were quite tough. And they had a lot of lessons to learn about Confucius in that, how society should be, what things should be. When Mao Zedong took over in 49, he had said Confucianism is not acceptable to a communist. We don't believe in hierarchy. He says Confucianism promoted kulaks or equivalent, landlords and kings, which communism is not happy about. For us, it is the farmer who counts, the laborer who counts, is the soldier who counts, and they are all the people who should be counted. Confucius, who believes in hierarchy, was literally taken out from their books for a good 30 years. But Confucianism is coming back again in the last 7-8 years, and Xi Jinping is emphasizing on Confucianism. You must understand this. We had said that China has had an imperial dynastic and the people, there is a relationship between them, hierarchy. Communist China today Xi Jinping is number one. He would like that hierarchy to be maintained. But it involves, it tells the people of China, okay, this is the hierarchy. It is the duty of the government to look after you. And the government is looking after you. This is what Confucius wanted. This is what we are doing. And we are keeping it in line with our old civilization. So it gives you pride. Gives you a sense of pride in our ancient civilization. Going back. In fact, you find this happening in many countries, including ours. There was a time for 50, 70 years, and in our own country, in India, people had said, forget all the old ways of living and this thing, and I think people are suddenly raising, yes, we have our own culture. We don't have to dump everything just because we are modern. So today, China has come to a stage when it says communism, but with Chinese modulations. Chinese moderations. They are not going for international communism, as was prescribed by Lenin. They are able to take in. Otherwise, they would not be inviting industries into China. Communism, you know, is definitely against private enterprise. But things have changed. They are willing to adapt it. So Communist Party in China has adapted itself greatly. And when many people thought in 1989 China will go the way of Russia or the USSR at that time, China did not. China did not collapse. Chinese learned the lesson, and Mao Zedong specifically was a great admirer of Stalin. And he thought Stalin was the ideal person, a communist. Now, communism has managed to ensure its continuity. It has adapted itself and also ensured prosperity for the people of the country. So it has done some wonderful work. It is still a developing country. It's not a fully developed country. Because though the GDP is high, it's not evenly distributed. There are some pockets where people are poor. Those on the eastern side of China, those who are working in industries, definitely are far better off than those on the western side. Places like Xinjiang and Tibet are still poor. So, Chinese know that they are very powerful. They have their army, navy, air force, whatever it is. You know, great powers try and impose their design on others, nothing new. They try and expand their hegemony. They somehow seem to get a little more aggressive, and when their pathways are somehow blocked or something like that. And they have a sense of entitlement. And here, Chinese have a sense of entitlement because of the old civilization and the fact that a number of countries have been vassals to them. Okay. They have their identification, racial, and they feel this heavenly mandate. That is what you call the Zhongwo. Chinese have the old Chinese system. They thought that earth was flat. Earth was flat, and in the center of the earth was China. The center of the earth was China, and there is heaven on the top. Half the heaven on the top and half of the heaven on the bottom, and China. And Chinese emperor sat in the middle of the country, and he was the center of the whole universe. See, that is their thought. They think that way even today. And they say, I am powerful, so I am the center of the world, so people have to bow down to me. You have to do this gutna take to me. I am the strongest guy. Well, they are still not the strongest, but they definitely are aiming for it. They are still aiming for it. So these are some of the things which seem to be ticking in their minds when they are seem to be taking these actions. Quite possible. Okay, here are two small little maps. Now you can see this. On the left side of the map, of the dark brown area was the empire of Han Chinese or something about 2000 years back. On the right side is now China has, whenever the emperors have been strong and powerful, they have been expanding. China has expanded so much. Then I showed you what the very first map. Today you see it's the largest country in Asia after Russia. They simply gobble up any territory which they can. And the local population just disappears. It's only a matter of time before Tibet is flooded with the Han Chinese and also the Uyghur region, Xinjiang. So this is what they have been doing throughout their history. That is expansion, expansion, expansion. And they are not stopping now. They are not stopping now. They say, we have been doing it, we'll continue to do that. Okay. Now, why this? Well, the last 10 years have been, we know, we can see what the history was like, but there is a sudden surge in the last 10 years. You know, Deng Xiaoping, a very wise man, I must say, we have to accept that. He was the one who sort of, after Mao Zedong's two terrible tragedies Mao Zedong inflicted on the Chinese. Two terrible things. One of the great leap forward and his aim to upgrade China's industry. Nearly 30 million people died and there was absolute chaos. Tiananmen Square, you have heard about that. Deng Xiaoping came after him and ensured to settle down a lot of things. He said, now it's time we change our track, start industrialization. The old work of communism will not work. The old methods of communism will not work. We have to look at the world in a different manner. And he says, for the next 20, 30, 40 years, let us keep quiet. Quietly keep on advancing. In fact, specifically with US, he says, increase trust, reduce trouble, promote cooperation, avoid confrontation. This is what the Chinese have been doing for the last 30 years. And the results are there for you to see. They have taken full advantage of the UN, of the WTO, of our friendship with them. They have done all that. And they have managed to come to a stage when they are the second superpower today. They are in competition with US. They may not reach the US level for quite some time, but then the fact is that they have raised themselves by their bootstraps thanks to this gentleman Deng Xiaoping. Okay. Now, what are the Chinese fears? No, obviously China, whatever their past is, whatever their strength is, they have their own fears thanks to the history. Look at this map of China. See, I've talked of borders, sea lanes, raw materials, neighbors, popular unrest and terrorism. These are things which are very much in their anybody. See, borders are sacred for us also. But in their case, they have, China has been subject to aggression from the north, Mongols and Manchus and Russians from the northeast for centuries. You know about the China Wall. What was the China Wall for? It was meant to keep the invaders from outside, ensure that the Mongols don't come in. So every strong warlord ensured a piece of China Wall was built to block off the people from his territory. Later on, the people came and then they joined this China Wall. It was not built in a day. It took them centuries to build it. But the main problem was the invaders from the north. So China has always felt very uncomfortable with aggressors from the north. And mind you, Manchus and the Mongols ruled over China for nearly 500 years in two different portions. The last Qing dynasty was itself a Manchu dynasty. They were not Chinese. Though Chinese now today say, okay, we absorbed you. So, and remember, even in the 60s and 70s, they had problem with Russia. There were clashes on the Ussuri River and nearly 20 divisions of Russians were placed there. It is only in the 90s that the matter of the islands was sorted out. Now their borders on the north are a little more secure. They have been insecure from the west also, from the side of Kazakhstan, from Turkmenistan. So borders are definitely a problem for them. In fact, 3 years back, I think they had a large military exercise. But from the north, it's tankable country. Nearly 2,500 tanks took part in that exercise. You can imagine what a large exercise. The photograph which you see of Xi Jinping with tanks in the background and troops in the standing and all that probably is from that side, from that time. Sea lanes. See, China gets 70 to 80% of its imports from the Middle East. It is also selling a lot of manufactured goods by sea lanes. Most of its oil comes from Middle East, from Iran, from Saudi Arabia, and something from Africa. And all the shipping lanes have to pass, whether from the Middle East or from Africa. They come from Africa and Saudi Arabia, come south of Colombo, come south of Sri Lanka, then go up a little bit, then Indonesia, then they come down to Singapore and go up once again to their coast. So this particular sea route is very, very vital for them. As also the sea lanes just to their east, which is the China Sea. This portion is very, very vital for them. Now, this place near Singapore and Indonesia, we call it this Malacca Straits. So this is a choke point for anything which is coming to them from Africa or Saudi Arabia. They're always afraid that someday that India, with the Nicobar Island sitting here, we have got our new command there, might choke them off. Or Indonesia can choke them off tomorrow. In which case, they'll be at a terrible disadvantage. See, China doesn't have the raw materials which it needs. It is completely dependent upon the Middle East and Africa for its fuel. It has to get its food grains from outside. It has come from by sea lanes only. And this is the choke point. They are afraid of this choke point getting blocked. In addition, the sea lane on the east of China. Unfortunately for China, you see Japan in the east, then Taiwan then Manila and Philippines and Borneo. They are not giving enough space for China to really go out to the main Pacific Ocean. Their path to the Pacific Ocean is blocked by this chain of islands, which are different countries. So this is an area which is a major concern to them. That is why they are very keen in increasing the strength of the Navy. They do not want that any of these countries should have strength enough to create any problem for them. So land borders are a nightmare for them, so are the sea borders. It is understandable. Okay. Raw materials have to come from outside. Remember, Japan had the same problem. The cause of the Second World War was that they could not manage the raw materials because raw materials were not available in Japan. Now, China is also dependent upon Africa, USA and Europe for raw materials. They have, so this is their weak point. They have to ensure the markets are open, that the sea lanes are open, the borders are open. And then the neighbors, they have been having this master-vassal relationship with neighbors, but now the but this is not the 18th or 16th or 15th or 10th century. Other countries are also becoming prosperous. People are becoming more and more demanding, and they are getting, they say, we also want to stand up on our own. Now, India, for instance, is not bowing down to them. So they feel constrained and not very happy with the situation that exists with their neighbors. Within their own country, no. Communist government is definitely strong, unitary, no doubt about it. But then the good points of industrialization has not petered down to everybody equally. They have to be always be careful that there is no popular unrest, especially in places like Uyghur and Tibet. So they are always worried about these things. That is the reason why they take drastic actions. Now see what has happened in Hong Kong. Even a little bit of hesitation in accepting what the Chinese Communist Party says, they come down very heavily. They have put 1.5 million Uyghurs in concentration camps. They are afraid. And they are especially afraid of terrorism. So that is one of the reasons why they want to be so chummy and pally with Pakistan, hope, and the Taliban, hoping that they will hold back the Uyghurs in line. They also want to develop good relations with Turkey, hoping that Turkey will ensure that from East Turkestan they are not being troubled. So these are some of these points. Add to that the fear that USA might choke them off in the Pacific. Mind you, China is getting a lot of crude oil from South America. Now they say, suppose the US guys trade it off, what do we do? They are not yet on the top of the food chain. There are people they are afraid of. We have to understand Chinese culture and their attitude toward the neighboring countries. You know, China expects every country to be subservient to them. They are used to this empire and hierarchy, master and vassal. They still do. It is economically, ministerially very, very strong. And they have control over many of these United Nations organizations. You know, out of 16 odd organizations, they are chairing, I think, 6 of them. They have fantastic control over many of these organizations. And see what they do in the Security Council. They got how they use the veto. They do not allow anything which does not suit them to pass at all. Fantastic. Chinese Communist Party owns its unquestioned authority. Chinese Communist Party, the people have no rights of their own. In fact, the last 10, 15 years, the younger people in China are much happier that they have a choice of education, choice of work, and choice of place of work. Well, it was not possible earlier. But this is all subject to the fact that they should not ask any political question nor take any political action. So long as you don't question the Communist Party, everything is hunky-dory. You can do what you like, you can start your own business, you can do wonderfully well. See what Jack Ma, how he got into trouble. He was one of the richest guys and great guy running so many industries and organizations. All that he did was to question the banking rules, the way the banks were being run. One question and he was flat. Taken on to a concentration camp or whatever it was for 2 months, he was not seen or heard. Now, he doesn't open his mouth, right? So long as you don't question the party, so long as you don't question Xi Jinping, you're fine. You can continue with what it is. That is what China is today. Okay, we have to understand this. See, when we got our independence in 47, our leaders were wonderful people, very patriotic and excellent people, very educated people. But they did not have this understanding of history. They wrote about history. Somebody like Jawaharlal Nehru wrote about history, talked about history. But did we draw the right lessons from history? We are very naive. Mahatma Gandhi said, everybody is equal, we should do. I remember I was in school and college at that time, people used to say, why do we require an army? Disband it. China is our friend and England will look after us. We have no enemies at all. Army should be disbanded. People were so naive. They thought everything was, because we thought Panchsheel was a good thing, we thought the whole world looked like that. This Vasudeva Kutumbakam is one of those real, there's only half the sentence. There's another half sentence to it. It has come in a number of places in our scriptures. Vasudeva Kutumbakam is everybody in the whole world is like one. But who says that? The wise people say like this. Those who are not wise do not say this. So you are wise, but you are not necessarily surrounded by people who are equally wise. The way they look at the world, the real politics is different. That's what we've been seeing so far as China is concerned. Their outlook on life is completely different. We can't deal with them based on our culture. You have to deal with them based on their culture, which is what we have to understand. And whenever in 47, 48, 49, 50, India was in a terrible shape. You know, so we had the refugees who were coming, pouring in. And all the time and effort was taken to settle these refugees from the east, from the west, from Punjab, from Bengal. We had no industry to speak of. Industries have been completely demolished over the years. We had idealistic outlook. We didn't learn from history. And in addition to this, Pakistan was giving us trouble every 5 years, 10 years. So all our concentration was on the West. Our labor policies, less we talk, the better. You see what happened from the 20, 25 years of communism in Bengal. Industry was completely wiped out. See what has happened in Kerala? No industry. And what has happened to the textile industry in Kanpur and Bombay? All wiped out. How and all that, that's a different story by itself. Maybe we can touch it some other time. See our own educational systems. For the last 50, 60 years, we have been saying, what have been saying? That we have been conquered by X, Y, Z for the last 1,000 years, we are unfit. We are unfit to govern ourselves. And this has been highlighted again and again and again. Then, see, when I said how China has increased its infrastructure, the money which we should have put in infrastructure, did we put it in welfare? These are debatable points, of course. And also the fact that we have no national policy. We don't seem to have a national policy on anything. And when we do have, we don't implement it. Every department is working in silos. The defense ministry does not know what the foreign affairs ministry is doing. Foreign affairs ministry does not take anybody else into account when they deal with other countries. Even in negotiations, just I think last week I was listening to who was it, General Ahluwalia, Lieutenant General, who was there in Doklam. So he was saying that they had negotiations to go on with the Chinese. And what did he say? He says, we from our Indian Army side, I was there and my officers were there. From the Chinese Army, they were there. He says, I wish I had somebody from the legal department. You know, when you're into negotiations, you need experts on so many areas and so many subjects. I understand while the Lieutenant General, the Corps Commander's meet was there, a Joint Secretary from the Foreign Ministry was also there. This is probably the first time it has taken place like that. You have to have people from different ministries and things who cooperate, understand the real problems. The army guy doesn't really understand the problems of foreign affairs, fine. So you must back him up with that. And the foreign ministry has gotten into a lot of, treaties and things without consulting the defense. And the results is there. I mean, the details of this, I can give you so many. All right. So we are saying OBOR is not good enough. It is creating a lot of problems. But are we in a position to take on the gap which OBOR will do? You see, how has OBOR come? You see, during the last 10 years, USA has spent about $7 trillion on useless things. Most useless was the war in Iraq, Afghanistan. They had no business to go in there. $7 trillion. Now, our infrastructure in Asia requires $6 trillion. Had that been invested in places like this, China would never have come up with an OBOR. You know, how things are wasted. You know, this is geopolitical. People waste things on unnecessary things. And we say OBOR, China should not be there. Then can I replace China? Can I do these projects in Bangladesh or in Myanmar or in Malaysia? Can we in India do that? These are things. We have to understand this. The history and the communist way of looking shows very clearly. Chinese appreciate only power. What did friend Mao Zedong say? Power grows on the barrel of a gun. And we also know that, Bai Bin Ho Na Priti, unless you have power, nobody is going to listen to you. China is practicing it. Remember, when we got our independence, who did we have as leaders? And who do we have as leaders even today? People who believe in Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. Now, who was Mao Zedong? This gentleman has been fighting. He started off with 60,000 people from Yunnan and in the march, and hardly 7,000 survived. He fought against the Japanese, he fought against the Kuomintang, he fought against the Koreans. Now, a person like Nehru, who, thorough gentleman, nicely brought up, a disciple of Mahatma Gandhi, how can they be thinking on the same lines? The one guy is completely militaristic in outlook. And the other person has been told ahimsa, paramo, dharmaha. So we are in a completely different world. We are in a completely different world. We have to accept that. And then see what is the next thing to be done. And mind you, China, we have had 5 major agreements with China in the last 40 years. Nehru ke saath, we had with Nehru, then we had with Rajiv Gandhi, then Narasimha Rao and so many things. All of them have been simply thrown to the side. Jinping has simply thrown everything to the side. And they accept anything so long as it suits them. And for them, all diplomacy and negotiations are only meant to put you to sleep and drop your guard, and they get back to what they were doing earlier. They just buy time. Oh, this, read what Kissinger was saying. You know, for them, time is of no value. It's a fact. They'll keep on talking to you. They'll keep on saying good things to you and keep on doing whatever they want to do on the ground. You get distracted, you're finished. That's what happened to us. And we have been following this appeasement policy year after year after year, and they have taken full advantage of it. They did us appeasement, they take it as a weakness. Any point which you give them is taken as a point of weakness. I'll give you one. I was reading one excerpt of a meeting of Chou En Lai somewhere in 60s, 61, 63, 64, with Enver Hoxha. Enver Hoxha is the communist boss of Albania. So he was telling him how Enver Hoxha was to have some dealings with the Russians, both were communists. And he was explaining how he should handle communist Russia. And this is one of the points which he was saying. Chou En Lai says, we want to have border talks with Nehru. We said, we have no preconditions. Nehru and his people were saying, no, we've got 4 conditions before we'll start talking with you. So we kept on saying, we have no preconditions, why do you insist on? Nehru said, no. So they gave us those preconditions, we prepared our answers for all that. We said no condition. But when we went for the negotiation, we said these are the 6 conditions from our side. And once we put these 6 conditions from our side, the Indian side was completely taken aback because they were not prepared for it. See, this is how they approach negotiations. They will always ensure that you are at the weak point. And if you open your cards, you're gone. Their approach to negotiation, you've got to learn. That's the study in itself. We have to negotiate from a position of strength. You saw what happened recently in Galwan Valley. We occupied certain higher heights, which put the communist army at a disadvantage. They immediately said, okay, after 3 months, let's have a negotiation. They have withdrawn a little bit, we have withdrawn a little bit. This is not the first time it has happened. Sumdrung, that was about 8-9 years back. No, 15 years back. Sumdrung also, similar thing happened. Chinese had come forward and occupied areas just near the border, right? We told them, you can't, these are places which you're not supposed to come to, and so you've got to go back. They didn't. We occupied higher heights there also. Once we occupied the higher heights, they said, okay, let's have negotiations. So long as you are in a better place and a situation for negotiation, they will negotiate with you. People said that after this Galwan Valley, they have gone back. They know that we will take on other areas which will be for negotiations. Nothing has moved forward because those places, China is at an advantage. They will not go back. They will not go back. They have been there for the last 15 years. They are not going back because you don't have an advantage. Simple as that. So you must negotiate from position of strength. Otherwise, just talking has no meaning. And any loose statement, any action which can be taken as a sign of weakness, we must avoid. That includes political statements by opposition leaders. The Chinese leaders are not used to anybody opposing any of their views. Here, when in a democracy, it's not like that. So what happens? The central government is not as strong as it should be. And it is weak, it can fall, and there is a dissension within the country. India is a large country and we can stand up to anybody. We have a population of 130 crores, but then we have to be economically strong. And we must shed our feeling of inferiority, which has been drilled into you from your childhood. And this feeling of being soft guy, nice guy, bahut achha ladka hai, you can give him two slaps and he'll still not return back. Oh, what a good boy he is. Well, that must go. That's what we tell our children. Please don't fight, don't do this, don't do that. No, stop that. If you are being bullied, you must fight back. We have to change our attitudes towards bullies. Absolutely. Why are we hesitating? Why are we not taking up the issue of Hong Kong, Taiwan? Okay, diplomats can't do it. You and I can do it. Let us do it. The people out in the public do it. Let those retired guys do it. Let us start shouting and say what you are doing in Uyghur is not right. Let us try and arm Vietnam and Philippines so that they can stand up on their own. Let us give them BrahMos missiles. We have to do that. Okay. Let's learn from history. One-sided treaties, we don't accept. Don't take any treaty, don't conclude any treaty on security matters unless you take the armed forces into account. This LOC, LAC business has come only because of that. Read Mr. Menon's book. It's one of the first chapters itself. He says how PLA dominates the negotiations. Okay. And what Chou Enlai also said about his own diplomats. Chou Enlai, once he was asked, what do you expect from a diplomat? He says, my diplomat is a strong supporter of PLA. And we will do whatever is required to ensure that the integrity of China's land is maintained at all times. So his diplomat is also a part of the PLA. Okay. Now, last but not least, why I was specifically wanted this particular talk was, you're all experts. There are many things we do not know. And the government of India so far has not been free with information. We do not know why many of the decisions were taken, even 20, 30, 40 years back. That Henderson report, which is no secret, is still held as a secret of why we met with the fiasco, why there was a fiasco in 1962. How many years have passed? 60 years have passed. That Henderson Brooks report, why can't it be made public? Look, the national security is not the sole prerogative of one government, one foreign minister, or his secretary or anybody. We must have an idea of what's happening around, and if they're making a mistake, we in the public must tell people, yes, this is not the way to do it. After all, this is a democracy, and we are people who are directly affected.
Mm. we'll have the question answer round now, Colonel sir. I'll ask Sri Ramakrishnan first to ask his question.
Yes, sir.
He is my namesake, so I have to listen to him first.
All right. Sir,
thank you for a very informative lecture. So, my question is that why is it that in India we do not see any kind of China study seriously for the last 70 years of after independence, 75 years after independence? We do not have Chinese language experts, which is a huge barrier in understanding their thought. I mean, only things that are translated by them into English are, you know, visible to us. So what is the reason for just neglecting this simple thing?
I don't think it was a purposeful neglect. Our attention has been focused on the West. America, America, America. UK, but children go to UK, children go to, then the people who are slightly less educated, they go to Saudi Arabia, to the Middle East for earning their bread. That's it. China has never been on our horizon for the last 1,000 years. That is the reason. See, we have been completely cut off from China. The only time we have come to China is after 47. India does not even have more than half a dozen decent NGOs, or what do you call this, study circles and things like that. IDSA, China Study Group, these are all recent ones. And they have never been encouraged by the government. In fact, China had started the Confucian schools in many parts of the country, in many parts of the world. I think one or two of them are there in our own universities. I agree with you. We need more people who will study China. In fact, I was reading a book by Anand Krishnan, a recent book which I said. He had gone there as a representative of the Hindu. You were saying the whole of China, there were hardly five or six Indian newspaper representatives. The whole of China. He says Western countries have so many. They even have the French, the Russians have even their TV channels. We don't have anything. We have been very inward looking and somehow not been outward looking. It's time we started that. It's time people like you and me start talking about China and say, yeah, these are the issues, let us talk about it. Did we talk about this 5 years back? We didn't. Let's talk about it now. And encourage our youngsters to take up Chinese as a course and a language. I agree with you, sir.
Krishnanji, do you have another question?
Yeah, so the other thing is that in India, it seems as if no government will eventually be powerful enough to confront China, which is a single party government, basically. So we are already projecting a kind of disorder in, from their viewpoint.
Yes.
Right. And, you know, I don't know. Why is it that even the so-called nationalist government is not taking that many steps to counter China on a proactive basis, like, for instance, stopping the export of iron ore or minimizing the export of iron ore? I mean, these are things that could have been done over time, especially export of raw materials, which is a no-no.
Yes.
I agree with you that there are many things which we should do, but then are we in a position to do that? Are we in a position to do that? That is the next question. Now, we wanted to reduce our dependence upon China by reducing its imports. Are our people ready for it? Is our trade ready for it? The industrial growth of China is very interesting when you study it. When they started having industries coming from outside, buying up land, setting up industries, many of their local industries had to taper down, even close down. This is called spillover. But what happens is, over a period of time, when you are able to get material from outside which are cheaper and better in quality, within the country you start new industries which will use this imported material, add on to it, and are able to export it outside. We have not been able to take advantage of the spillover. We have been very afraid of our, we have been closing down our own industries, closing down our businesses, but we have not been starting new ones. And why have we not been starting new ones? That is because of our own industrial policy and labor policies. We have not taken advantage of the cheaper imports from China for improving our own requirements or manufacturing. We have been taking those items. Now, for instance, if we are getting LEDs from China, if we are getting these items for TV, we should be able to manufacture the other items and put them on road. Our vehicles are getting items from China, but we have been able to increase the production of vehicles. So it has to be like that. Today, no country can say, I produce everything and nobody produces anything else, I will take nothing from anybody. Or I will stop sending things to China. But we do require imports. So far as trade is concerned, when the new trade starts, there will always be imbalance. The person who can sell a better quality store at a cheaper price will always be at advantage. The aim is not to stop that other guy from bringing in things, but to see how best you can utilize it to produce even cheaper stores and ensure that if not that store, you produce something else and send it to him. Simply blocking out somebody's iron ore will not serve the purpose. The point is, why are we not using that iron ore inside our country to produce steel, which goes out and comes back? Now, that is how we should look at it. Why are we not using that iron ore? We are not looking at it from that point of view. Why are we not doing that? Okay, sir.
Vijay Kranti ji.
Yeah. Sure. Thank you, sir. It was a pleasure listening to you, and especially the insight you have given about China, their mindset. Thank you very much for that. It was very enlightening. Still, I would wish you could underline 2, 3, 4, 5 points which are the soft underbelly of China, where we hit and they feel hurt. Because I find that every time we are focused on border, the India-Tibet border, they create problems and we handle it. We only react even on that issue. I would request you to please underline 2, 3, 4, 5 underbelly points where China is very weak and where we should hit, rather we should leave the issue of border and start hitting them with those points where it hurts them most, and then they will come to negotiating table to behave like a good boy.
Absolutely right, sir. This is exactly what is required. We know, I have listed out certain areas of their weaknesses, right? 5 or 6, starting with the border, with their maritime lanes and what they are importing. If I remember right, I think I'd put those out. Let me see if I want. Okay, take the border for instance. People see today in the strategic side, people say you should, China and Pakistan are in coalition and you have a two-front war. We really are not prepared for a two-front war. But, sir, just remember, China also has got borders. Pakistan also has got borders. Why do you think we should not, do whatever is required to ensure that some of their attention from our border is shifted to their borders? You have to do that. Now, how are we going to do that? If Pakistan is concentrating his forces on behalf of China too. See, he is doing it on his behalf. He is being supported. So there's no reason why Pakistani army should sit with us. Okay. Pakistan has given Baluchistan is an area where the Chinese have invested a lot of money and got our port. Their weak point, or rather their points of concern, have to be taken advantage of by us. The Uyghurs, East Turkmenistan. Well, there are a lot of people who definitely will go to Xinjiang and do that and help them out. See what is happening in Tibet. See, we gave away Tibet without a single shot being fired. Just handed it over to them. We have a Tibetan government, but we have not, acknowledged them. Today, you say you form a government. You form a government in exile. And you go to the UN, take a seat there and start shouting. What stops us from doing that? You say Vietnam. See, Vietnam is having problems. Philippines is having problems. Right now, I think there are 200 Chinese vessels are standing in one single place in Vietnam, with Philippines. Now, why are we not providing Vietnam with BrahMos missiles? Why are we not providing BrahMos missiles to Indonesia or Philippines or somebody? With ground-to-air missiles or ground-to-ground missiles, or short distances. So, which at least will deter China from brazenly taking advantage of their weaknesses. See, they are very small countries. Small countries and with very limited resources. Okay. So, you don't charge them full amount for this BrahMos. You say, okay, I give you 50% off. Take it. Or tell USA, yeah, you subsidize something, le lo, naam iska hai. How has Pakistan been getting its armament? It has been coming through Saudi Arabia. It has been coming from Turkey. Okay. So there's no reason why you have to go and do it yourself. You can help somebody else to do it. It's all a question of your, first of all, you must open up your mind. You get out of this feeling that you have to react. You are very right when you said you are only reacting. Why are we reacting? We should be proactive. This vaccine diplomacy was proactive for the first time. Well, wonderful. We have to do that. And after a long time, we have started having good relationship with the Middle East and the Far East. We didn't have it thanks to Modi. I know many people don't like to say that, but it's a fact. Though Far East policy was started off with Narasimha Rao's time, but it was not really progressed. Now we are progressing it. Have good diplomatic relations everywhere. So arm those people who require to be armed. Diplomatically deal with people who are to be diplomatically deal around. You say Quad policy, okay, let us join it. We have been saying no alliances, no alliances. Why no alliances? If you require help, you say yes. I may not take help, but at least I'll say yes, I'm a party to you. Let the other fellow feel that we are five people. Why I should not keep on saying that mai iske saath nahi milta hun? I'm not for this. Why? You say yes, I will choose alliances with whom I want to do, when I want to do, the way I want to do, and on my own conditions. Why should we say no? Do that. Nobody is stopping you. Who is stopping us? Ourselves. Why are we stopping it? Because we are afraid. Are, kya ho jayega? Why have we not taken up the issue of Hong Kong? Why are we not taking up strongly with Taiwan and importing more things from Taiwan? Why are we not highlighting the problems with, you know, the way the Zambian people are being treated by Chinese? Why are we not taking it up? What stops us from doing all that? Why are you not telling Russia, why, look at this? And we have to tell America, don't, now at least Biden has come, don't push Russia so much that he he becomes a second line partner to China. That's what is happening today. Russia was comparatively much better friend of ours and for the last so many years. But now he started towing China's line. Why has he started doing it? Because of American pressure. So we have to tell the Americans, yeah, leave off, thoda sa usko, let saans lene do. Don't keep on pile sanction after sanction. Now Biden has come, why can't we tell Iran? Iran has been with us by and large supportive. After the Shah of Iran went, Shah of Iran was 100% backer of Pakistan. But the new Iran has been comparatively more friendly towards us. Why we are not buying more oil from him? China is doing that. Let us do that. Let us take him on our side. So we have to take people on our side, diplomatically and quietly, without making any fanfare. Let's do that.
Vijayji, do you have another question? You can just nod.
May I have only one comment?
Yes.
Colonel Ram, you very nicely pointed out about Deng Xiaoping, the new approach he gave to China, new direction he gave.
Yeah.
The results we are seeing today, he said that increase trust with others, reduce trouble with others, promote cooperation and avoid confrontation. Mm. You know, these are 4 points which he added. Do you think I'm wrong or it's an overstatement? I see these points very much in the Modi era. He is adopting very, very similar policies. The way he is increasing trust across the world or avoiding direct confrontation. You know, he did it with Pakistan, gave them a lesson, but didn't implement it further. He handled China, but still like Doklam, confronted them very strongly, but at the same time didn't let it explode into a direct confrontation. Same thing in Ladakh. And the way he is promoting cooperation and, you know, I find that here we have another Deng Xiaoping of India. Yes. Do you think it's a wrong or bad statement?
I think after many years, after many decades, we are having a proactive policy on many fronts. On the diplomatic front, on the industrial front, and on the military front. We are taking stands. We are at least started drawing red lines. See, the real issue is that we do not have a national strategic policy. I heard this gentleman Menon saying that 4 or 5 times this national strategic policy was drawn up. You know, USA comes out with it, UK comes out with it, China comes out with it. But we are not doing it because the political masters are not happy. Because they say if we make a commitment of what our national strategy is and the stand we should take, then they will be questioned. Now, that cannot be reason for not having a national policy. Abhi, what's happening? For instance, small. Why national policy is required? There's a petroleum ministry. Now, petroleum ministry says we are importing 60% of our fuel from place X, Y, Z. Okay. Then the national policy must say, yes, we have to ensure this 60% of fuel which comes from outside will be protected on the sea lanes. And say that it is the responsibility of the Shipping Corporation of India or that the ministry doing the shipping, taking care of the shipping to ensure this much shipping is available for it. And also tell the Navy that you are responsible for the protection of these ships which come from all the way from Bahrain to this place. So there are 2, 3, 4 people involved. And also the local governments who have to ensure that we have a place specifically for storing this fuel which comes from outside. We have to have, you say, 6 weeks of stock ready. Then land acquisition comes into place. The local rules and regulations come into place. The state governments will also have to play a role in that. So when you have a national policy on certain things, then everybody gets involved. Abhi the people are working in silos and individually. So national physical policy is very much required on every item and in details. You're right. I wish we do that.
Sir, I have a question before we go to the next people. China's great leap forward. They say between 15 to 55 million people died.
Yes.
China's cultural revolution, nobody has the figure. Millions of people and soldiers and everybody died. China's Tiananmen Square, although it's not official, but they say around 10,000 students died. Where do the Chinese still get their sense of nationalism, and how can we Indians learn from them?
This is where that civilizational aspect comes. Whatever the government does, see, he's considered to be the Confucius way of thinking. Oh, he's doing the right thing. Secondly, the information doesn't spread at all. You know, they have a complete blanket ban on any information. The way you are open to the world, China is not open to the world. Now, even this Galwan Valley, we say, how many of our soldiers had died? 20. Now, I am sure at least 40 of them had died, and but 100 people had got injured. But it took them 4 months just to acknowledge that three of their soldiers had died. And the people are not even aware what's happening. When they had this war in Korea, 900,000 was the casualties. 900,000? Nobody knows. 30 million people had died thanks to Mao Zedong. See, it varies from 25 million to 45 million. And there are descriptions.
One-sixth of population of Tibet has been wiped out since they occupied it.
Which one? Say again, please.
One-sixth of Tibet's population.
Yes, yes, possible. Yes, they'll do that. The rest will be assimilated. It's only a matter of time. Same is going to happen in Xinjiang. All the Muslims will be put in one place. The hands have already started going there. And industries have opened and they're all being banned by Han. And the population is changing definitely. It's only a matter of 10, 15 years. The Muslim population will be minority. Yes. This is what they have been doing for centuries. See, the one small little map which I showed you was hardly one-fifth of the area which China occupied. They have been expanding, and their governments, their emperors have encouraged people to go and settle outside. They are doing that today also.
Yes.
CCP, China passed a law that you could be arrested for this. Please answer.
So, communist China is the boss.
And why China only? Do you see that in Pakistan also? They said anybody who says anything against the army will be arrested and sent to jail. Countries come out with rules like that. They don't want anybody to open their mouth and say anything else. They are not democracy. It's not democracy. In fact, it doesn't even have to give this rule. They can catch anybody and put them inside. See what happened to Jack Ma, such a big guy, and everybody knew him around the world. Just disappeared. Nobody knew what happened to him. And that has happened to anybody and everybody who in Hong Kong, whoever has been taking part in this in their little protests and whatever it is, they just simply disappear. It's a dictatorship. And so far as our inability or lack of real activity on the cyberspace is concerned, I think now slowly we are waking up. We are waking up very slowly. We are supposed to be experts so far as software is concerned, but the government really has not taken full advantage of this. We have monitoring stations and things, but then these things have to be put together. There must be a central authority who will get inputs from Army, Navy, Air Force, Civil. And let me just say this, add this one thing. In the case of Communist China, you know, the ships which come, fishing trawlers, they also acquire information and pass it back. It's not that in our side only the government vehicles will or government ships will go and get information. There, everybody is there, a part of the government. Anand Krishnan says, in a colony, there will always be some old ladies and old gentlemen who will be moving around with a red band. They are the eyes and ears of the government, for the local government. They keep a track of who is coming, who is going, which house is occupied by whom, what action is being taken. So that is how they gather information. Nothing is left. There's no privacy, there's no, no freedom as such. See, this is a unitarian government, it's a communist government. I mean, it works like that. We are a democracy. There's no right to speech there. Okay, accept it.
I saw a report recently as to how they had passed a law about something like our Swachhata Abhiyan. You have to keep your houses clean, and how soldiers actually come into your houses and harass you and check everything there. I mean, they rub their fingers across the furniture and tell you if there is dust, then you can be imprisoned. Every little aspect of it.
Yeah, they do.
Sir, it is 1 o'clock and we have about 6 questions to go, and you can tell me when to stop. I'll go to Jasoda ji now.
Yes.
Namaste, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
I have 2 questions. So, yes, one question is that when we look at our media, academia, politics, we see there's a rise of anarchy. Rise of anarchy, and it has a face of socialism. So today when we see even our mainstream parties like Congress is behaving more like a socialist party, wherein they are saying why the vaccine is for 400 rupees and why not 200 rupees? Why are we not giving it to free for everyone? They are not talking about poor people. They're talking about everyone. No bars. And when we look at all these things, we see that we know that who is funneling the money, you know, to do all that. It cannot just be West. Of course, there's China is a big, a partner there. So don't you think that for Indian diplomats or the Indian government, even if they don't write in the manifesto, the thing for them or the milestone for them should be to find a stable diplomatic relation with China so that we both can coexist and have a peaceful South Asia.
Yes.
Do you think the government is working towards this? Because as a common man or as a common person, I don't see that happening too much. We are just berating China, we are berating Pakistan, but we're not really working much on it. So is there something happening on that front?
See, Yasodhaji, you've touched 2-3 points. So I hope I'm able to take them one by one. I've forgotten the first one. The first one was about the various parties saying different things, okay, in public. Look, this is a democracy. This is a democracy. We accept it. And fortunately or unfortunately, right from the time of our independence, you know, most of our leaders were legal luminaries. Okay? All, lawyers, advocates. Now, that has percolated into every aspect of our constitution, rules, regulations. Now, with China, for instance, we have border disputes. And these disputes have come because of certain agreements, treaties, which were half agreed upon, half not agreed upon, and all that. Like McMahon line, like in the western side. And our Indian leaders have gone about in analyzing all these treaties very legally. What China has been doing it is addressing it politically and militarily. So we are not two different set of worlds altogether. We say, I'll take it to the central, International Court of Justice. Yeah, legally you will win. But on the ground, that guy is sitting on the ground. He is dominating you. So legal quibbling and spitting hairs will not get us anywhere. We have to take ground as the major factor, power as the major factor, diplomacy as the major factor, if we want to be in the real world. That is one of the reasons why, for anything, we have got 20-odd high courts. Take this COVID affair. Every second day, some high court or the other comes out with certain statement. Oh, you people are no good, you have not done this. And somebody says, by 12 o'clock, I want so many oxygen. So everybody has become, so high courts have taken over the job which is to be done by the executive. They are telling executive what is to be done. And they are also telling the executive, you are no good, absolutely useless. Demoralizing these people who are running from morning till night. They are telling the doctors how to run hospitals. They are telling the nurses how to judge people. Right? Yeah, everything is legal. There's not a single subject which doesn't land up with the Supreme Court. The fact that we got 3 crore, cases still standing there. Everything is legal. And anything happening, anybody says, I have a right to sneeze. I have a right to sneeze in your face. It's the Constitution says so. Where does it say I cannot sneeze? Where does it say I cannot cough? And there will be a great guy. There will be people who will take up that case in the Supreme Court. They get special adjustments also. It's a fact. Now maybe it has to stop. It has to stop somewhere. And this, we have All India parties. We have parties, All India, India added to them, which means they have presence everywhere. But are they really national in their outlook? That's a different question. We know that certain parties have been getting money from foreign countries. Officially, they have been getting it. We have seen photographs of one major party. So once they have been getting money from outside there, and border mein problem ho raha hai, uski ghar mein khana kha raha hai. So what do you expect from these people? All India party, but is it a national party? We are faced with that today. Unfortunately, yes. I hope I have answered one part of your question. These are facts.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So, I think you have answered most of it. Just one thing was that how do we force BJP to work, on the diplomatic ties with China and make sure that we have a stable South Asia? Because this border conflict is a headache for them as well as for us.
It is very incorrect you're assuming that we are not taking sufficient steps. The fact that we have had 5 major agreements from the time of Rajiv Gandhi, Narasimha Rao, and then Manmohan Singh, and Modi has met friend, Xi Jinping 16, 17 times. Usko bulaya, usko chai pilaya, usko jhule bithaya. And every time there is a meeting, right now for Doklam and things, there have been 8, 9, 10 meetings, one after another. That is what I was saying, that Chinese will keep on talking to you, but will never agree to your point, unless it suits them. We have been talking. The fact that we have been talking and giving up so much, all this giving up has not resulted in the Chinese acceptance of the fact that you are an equal, and they have to come to some understanding with them for peace. Tranquility and peace, the reports are there, everybody has signed on it. But they break it anytime they want to. And it's not only with us. They do it for everybody. See what they are doing to the Philippines. See what they are doing to Indonesia. So don't think that we are the only one. That is why I projected. They are creating problem wherever they want to, whenever they want to. And nobody is spared of their pinpricks. They want to dominate this world and be number one and be like those emperors. Anybody who kowtows to them, agreed. Otherwise, they're going to trouble you. But that does not mean stop talking. We learn from them. We will continue to talk with you and do what is the best in our interest. They are doing that, we should do that. And Modi government is talking and talking and talking. We will continue to talk. We have not stopped talking. Who has said we have stopped talking? You're not. Anytime we talk. I think that's what it is. We are doing more than enough. We should continue to do that.
Okay, next question, Dr. Sanjay.
Yes, madam. Thank you. Thank you, sir, for your lecture. You advocated a more aggressive approach towards China. You said we should pick up, the Taiwan question, deepen relations with Philippines, more aggressively pursue the Tibet question, and so forth. But I'm afraid this is going to lead to problems because we are a weak country, let's face it. And when a weak country tries to be very vigorous and aggressive with a country much stronger, then you can get something like 1962 when Nehru said he has ordered the troops to throw out the Chinese, and we know what happened after that. So to pursue these things vigorously, firstly, we have to modernize our economy, and that we haven't succeeded in doing. That is one point you did not explain adequately, why we can't modernize our own economy to keep pace with China. Of course, we can pursue these questions, Tibet, Taiwan, in alliance with the United States. And the United States is going to do that because they know that China's weak points are Taiwan, Hong Kong, Tibet, and Xinjiang, and they are going to pursue that. We can do so in alliance with the US, but that alliance has yet to fructify. So the future will tell whether that really happens. At the moment, our big challenge has to be modernizing our own economy so that we become a stronger country. And then, of course, we can stand up to China. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Saab. You were the first to raise the hand, and I'm sorry we are answering you so late. But then you raised very relevant points. But then this feeling that we are weak and therefore we should not stand up for ourselves, I'm afraid that has been the song for the last 30, 40, 50 years. And that has led us to a certain psychological feeling of ineptitude. Oh, we can't do anything. We have to accept whatever is being done to us. I think we should get out of that mindset. India is a large country. We are sufficiently strong enough to stand up at least for ourselves. And when I say go to Taiwan, I'm not saying take a division to Taiwan and make them sit there or to Vietnam. No. There are ways and methods of ensuring that we support these people. Now, that has to be done diplomatically, let us do it. Financially, we do it. Through infrastructure, we do that. We have to do these things very in a cool, calculated manner. It's not a question of aggression for the sake of aggression. It is the question, or the point is, China should realize that if they take half a step forward, to ensuring that we are at a disadvantage, we will take two steps forward to ensure that they are disadvantaged some other place, not necessarily in the same place. There must be retaliation or reactions, which they, in a language they understand. It is not necessarily military warfare, but if so required, you'll be mentally prepared for it. We have to ensure that our army, navy, air force are sufficiently equipped. Our industries are in a terrible mess. We are unable to make even rifles for our own jawan. It's a shameful state of affairs. Our industry has been destroyed. Our labor policy has destroyed our industries. That's no doubt about it. And we still, Israel which came, got its independence, we are buying armaments from them. It's a shameful state of affairs. They, 4 days back, China has Xi Jinping floated one aircraft carrier, one destroyer, and a nuclear-powered submarine, three of them on the same day. We have one aircraft carrier under refurbishing or whatever you call it, we expect to come in 2022. I mean, we can't keep on sleeping like that. And we'll, at this rate, we will never be strong enough. And this think if we will strong enough, then we will stand up. No, you will stand up when you are. Stand up where you are, with what you have. That's what the army chief said. We fight with what we have. Let us stand up. And stop saying, I say again, stop saying we are weak. We are not weak. And we will not allow ourselves to be called weak. Not anymore. Not anymore. This negative thing must go. Get it out of our minds. I don't want any of those youngsters to listen to this. We are strong and we will be strong. That's it.
Thank you very much, Colonel. It's almost 1:20 now, so I think we will close the meeting now.
Thank you.
And there are still a few questions. Maybe we can have a Q&A round with you sometime. And everybody, like always, there are links in our chat box for you. Please donate. Please connect with us on our newsletter and on other channels. And see you in the evening. Thank you, Colonel, sir.
Thank you.